Good morning. I guess we'll get started now. It's 8:30. No couple still rolling in. First off, thank you for being here Friday morning after the party or whatever other activities you may have partaken in last night. I know how difficult it can be to show up for these morning sessions on a Friday. But I hope you had a good week so far. It's been a pretty good dev summit. We've had a lot of really good time here. Learned a lot of new things. So my name is Rene Rubalcava. I work on the JavaScript team, and I also work with the apps group in Esri. Today we're gonna be talking about using TypeScript with the JavaScript API. I'm not gonna get into too many details on TypeScript itself. I'm gonna cover some basics, but this isn't a TypeScript tutorial session, but I'm gonna show you some of the basics and how you can use TypeScript right away to start developing your applications with the JavaScript API and some of the guidance that we provide. There's a lot better resources out there on learning TypeScript itself that I'll go over as well to take it back home and some future references for you to work on. I don't have a lot of slides either. I've got some slides like intro stuff, but once we're done with the slides, we're gonna go dive right in, start looking at some code and other sites that we have reference material on, so you can give you guys a good look over all that. So even if you want to get the slides, I have them on GitHub here. You can see the URL in the browser. I don't know how useful they'll really be. There's a couple of links in there, but it may be pretty helpful to you. So let's talk about what is TypeScript. How many people here, I think there was the Dojo 2 widget session yesterday. How many people here saw that there in this room? All right, cool. So you guys saw some of the stuff that was being shown with the TypeScript and the Dojo 2 widgets. Dojo 2 and Angular 2 are probably two of the largest projects right now that are TypeScript driven and have helped drive a lot of the TypeScript development over the past couple of years or so. They make a lot of issues and get a lot of input into the TypeScript team to get things going. But at the end of the day, TypeScript is what is referenced as a superset of JavaScript, meaning that unlike other languages that compile down to JavaScript, like CoffeeScript, ClojureScript, PureScript, there's a few other ones, GHCIJS, I believe. Other than like some of those other languages, a JavaScript code right now is just valid TypeScript. TypeScript is a whole new language. It's just a superset of the language that can add some sugar on top. And it basically is a good way to start using some of the newer features of the JavaScript language, specifically things like ES7, ES8. ES6 features are pretty much all a given at this point. And you can almost literally, I say almost, I know people that do it and it doesn't work. You can almost literally just change the file extension of a JavaScript file to a TS file, and it will compile from TypeScript down to JavaScript. And if you do that, it may even complain to you that, hey, something's wrong with your JavaScript, you need to do something right. You're using the function in two different ways, or you're doing some kind of weird stuff. It's a good way to actually find if you have taken a liberties writing your JavaScript code and we're a little lax in some things. So it does include a lot of the ES8 features. They just, with the 2.0 releases that have been coming up, they added the async await, which if you're not familiar with that is a way to be able to, how many people here use C#? Let's go with that. All right, you guys are already TypeScript developers. I don't even know why you're here. So I used to joke and jokingly say that TypeScript was for the C# developers and Dart was for the Java guys. And apparently no one cared about Dart because I don't think anything's happened with that. But essentially it is. If you're start writing your TypeScript code and you know C#, you're gonna wonder exactly it's all the same. I mean, you start looking at everything the same. You're typing things. Async await is inside a TypeScript, so you can wait for asynchronous functions to happen. We call them their generators inside of JavaScript. And it used to be that if you used async await in TypeScript, you had to compile that code down to ES6 JavaScript, run that through something like the Babel compiler for JavaScript to get your generators working in ES5 code. TypeScript now will do all of that for you. You don't have to worry about any of that stuff. So if you write an async await function, it'll convert it down to ES5 code for you, and you can live it happily ever after. Generators aren't magic. Async await isn't magic. It's like promises and everything else, except it's not as convenient to catch errors because you have to start wrapping things in try catch methods. You have to try the async await, and the only time you get errors is if you catch it. As far as I know, that's the only way to really catch errors there. But I'm getting off on the tangent anyway. But point is, you can start using a lot of these newer features in JavaScript inside of TypeScript, but you have the ability to start typing things. So the TypeScript compiler is smart. It does allow type inference for you, basically meaning that if you say that a variable is going to be an array of numbers, for example, in this case floats or doubles, I guess, it's going to know that that's an array of numbers. You don't have to tell it it's an array of numbers. This little syntax here is how you would just type it, number with an array. You can get away without doing that. The compiler's smart enough to know what's happening. You could type everything this way, but you don't necessarily have to. And actually, I think now, with the latest version of TypeScript, you will, you can set up your TSLint to tell you that you don't care about these kind of typings. You don't need strict typing. And that if you do something like this, you'll be fine. But if you do this, the compiler will say you have an unnecessary typing in your TypeScript code. Let the TypeScript compiler do the inference for you. Don't worry about doing that. So some things that aren't valid that you could normally get away with, especially when you are writing to the DOM. So if you pass a number as a inside your inner HTML equals a number, it would convert that number to a string for you. The TypeScript compiler is not as forgiving as methods like that. So if you have you create a set variable here, and I tell that variable it's going to be a array of numbers, I can equal that to array of numbers. But if I try and equal it to array of strings that look like numbers, even though they look like numbers, and you may expect something behind the scenes to convert them to numbers, it won't. So you can't do that. That's a completely invalid way of doing things in TypeScript, and the compiler will just yell at you. So interfaces. So here again, if you've worked in C#, if you've worked in Java or any other language, I mean, interfaces are available in TypeScript. And they're pretty strong way of using TypeScript. And sometimes it sounds weird, I don't say it much because it's not really the proper phrasing, but you can almost say that TypeScript is an interface-driven language, although interface-driven has a different meaning when you're talking about stuff. But it almost is, because there's other languages that you would say are type-driven languages. But TypeScript uses interfaces heavily. So interfaces are basically contracts in your code, that if you are going to give an interface to a class, you need to satisfy the contract of that interface for the class to be valid. The same goes for objects. If you create an interface for an object you're going to create, then you need to satisfy the contract that you're setting up in your program to meet that interface. In this case here, I have an interface for props, which are going to be properties I'm going to use. The props are going to have a map view called a view, initial center, which I have another interface or a type, which I'll talk about in a second, called coordinates. And I have an interface for point, right? So I have a point, it's got x, y, give me number. Cool thing with interfaces, you can extend interfaces. So I could take an existing interface, extend it, and start adding new contract variables onto that, or contract functions. In this case, I wanted a 3D point, so I just give it a z variable. This is all very, I know, it's kind of simple stuff, but I just want to get over some of these basics here. Type alias. So I use types a lot. Maybe I shouldn't, I don't know. When TypeScript first came out, they talked about types a lot to create these type aliases. And I think interfaces just kind of won in the early TypeScript days, that you use interfaces for everything. I'm still a big fan of creating my types to use them. One of the reasons I do like them, and I know this is why we don't use them a lot, is that you cannot extend a type. So if I create a type, it's its own type. I can't extend a type and start adding new variables onto that type. But I like to do that because that forces me to start shaping my types when I'm doing my application so that I know what I'm doing. I don't get surprised. If I have an interface that I pulled from somewhere and I extended that interface, add variables to it, I don't know what those original variables are until I start working with the interface. And it just, for me, it just does it, it throws me off sometimes. But anyway, so I create like the same thing here. Instead of an interface, I create a type point with X, Y of numbers. I have another properties here called UI params, and actually will show you where this gets used in a sample app that I'll show you that has an element. The element could be either an HTML element, or it could be a string, meaning that the string is gonna be maybe the ID for a DOM element. We use this in our source code a lot for the view and the UI stuff. And then a position. If you give it the position a question mark, that means it's optional. You don't need to actually pass it in. But optional, that's arguments, I'm sorry. We'll talk about, I won't really be talking about optional arguments. I forgot I had a slide for that. But if you have optional arguments in TypeScript, the optional arguments have to go at the end of your argument list. So you can't put an optional argument first and then have the second argument be required. It wouldn't make sense to do that. So optional arguments have to go after the end of your argument list. Again, if I want to make an array of points, I want to type that array. I just type it out as an array of points with this little bracket syntax we saw earlier. And I got a function here that's going to take a point and to take my params. And I've got a nice contract set up in my application of what a function is going to do. It's really easy for me to see what it's going to do. One of the benefits you get out of using TypeScript is that it's going to tell you if you're doing something wrong in your development. It's not a an excuse not to write tests, but it helps writing your applications better and will actually help you write your tests better as well. I'm not going to talk about tests. I'm not the test guy you want to talk to. Classes. So, okay, we have classes in TypeScript as well. So you create a class with a class keyword, and we have this in JavaScript now. It's a part of ES6. You can create a class, and you can implement an interface with that class. And when you do that, like I mentioned before, you have to satisfy the contract of the interface that you're trying to implement. So we had that point 3D interface we made earlier. It's got X, Y, Z, and we're good to go. We're satisfying the contract for my class. I could have had some functions in here to do some cool stuff, and that would have worked as well. One thing that TypeScript cannot do at the moment is extend multiple classes. So I can't have a TypeScript class that extends point and also extends some other class I may have out there. It just, it's not built into the language, as well as it's not in ES6 either. That's part of the problem, is it wasn't in ES6. There was just, recently, TypeScript 2.2 added new functionality called mixins, which I won't get into. It was too new by the time I was preparing all my slides and stuff to do. But it'll basically let you mix in other classes with your class, but there are some limitations in terms of higher order functions, I hear. I need to do more reading on it to actually talk more about it, but the general idea is that it may help us solve some of those particular multiple class extension problems. The way and I'll show you how we do it in the JavaScript API when I show you some samples of how we do multiple class inheritance. So these are some of the tooling configuration that you would use. TSC is basically the TypeScript compiler. If you install TypeScript using NPM, I think maybe there's other ways to install it. I don't know, I just do it via node NPM. The command is a TSC. It's got a lot of different options. The editor that we use mostly in-house, the JavaScript team, is Visual Studio Code. We still have guys using WebStorm, though. They're all about their WebStorm. I was using Vim for a long time. I still use Vim a lot, but writing TypeScript in Vim isn't exactly the greatest of an experience. So Visual Studio Code is what I've moved to for that. We have typings for both 3x and 4x. If you find issues with our typings while you're using them, you can make an issue on our GitHub repo, and I'll show you that in a moment, and we'll try and resolve it because the good thing is that we can fix the typings in between our releases. They're not tied to the release themselves, so we can always update our typings as we go along. And then if you're, and I'll show this too, because if you're doing the dojo typings, there's a little bit of extra little things you add to your configuration to do that if you need to. If you're using the 4x version of JavaScript API, you probably don't need to ever touch the Dojo typings unless you're going to use something Dojo specific yourself. So if you want to use like Dojo based slang, if you want to use Dojo on to listen for events or something like that, you're perfectly welcome to. But with the 4x version of JavaScript API, we obfuscate so much of the Dojo tooling that we use under the hood that you really don't need to worry about it. So this is already outdated. We do our constructors differently, and I need to get the sample from one of our guys. But this does work. One of the issues that we had with multiple inheritance when we write our TypeScript was keeping our typings, meaning that if I have this scene layer that extends both a layer and a scene service, we weren't able to get the typings from, say, our scene service. They wouldn't show up when we're trying to validate the code and everything. It was a real mess for us. So we came up with this method here where we have these helper modules inside the JavaScript API. These are just right here, decorate, extends and decorate. You'll never actually use them. You bring them in via this AMD dependency at the top of your TypeScript file when you're gonna work with doing class extension. And these are essentially the methods that will get created by TypeScript when you do class extensions and you use decorators. It creates these helper methods for you. But if we provide them as part of the build process, in this case, it will not generate them, so you won't have all these files that you're creating classes with these extra two methods at the top for each file. We have one that you reference somewhere else, and it's less code, and it's just for bringing the code size down a few kilobytes on a large project or so. It's really just a few bytes, mostly. So we have this it's a folder in the API called Esri Core TS Support, and in that folder is a couple of modules. The helpers that I just talked about, but also a module called Declare. This Declare module uses Dojo base declared under the hood to help us do our multiple class inheritance, and really Dojo base declare is the only it's not the only one, but it's the only stable JavaScript module out there that can do multiple class inheritance the way that we need it to be done with the working on the chain and everything, and prototype chain and stuff. It works really nicely. So we still use it under the hood. We have this declared method that we bring in. We have a subclass decorator that we're bringing in. Don't worry about, I brought in shared read write just to show that they're there, but these are the other ones that are in there. So what we do is we create an interface that's going to extend a layer, that's going to extend a scene service, and then we create a base constructor interface. And when you create interfaces, if you want to type the constructor, use the new keyword, is what we're doing here. So you don't use the constructor word, you use new keyword, and that's how the TypeScript compiler knows, hey, you're trying to do something with the constructor to type your return value when you create a new instance of this class, when you use this with a class. And so when we have a constructor, we're gonna return base, meaning that I wanna return these two interfaces here. Then we have a function called getBase, that's basically just gonna return the layer itself. And I have this any type here, meaning I don't know what kind of layer it's gonna be. I just need to return any layer. Try to avoid using any as much as you can in your TypeScript. Any really is just a way for you to quickly say, I don't care about my types. I just want to return any type and don't bother me. It may be a way to get away with prototyping some stuff pretty quickly, but if you're just going to be using any all over the place, I mean, you're kind of defeating the purpose of using TypeScript to type out all of your code. We have the subclass decorator. Now, the subclass decorator works in conjunction with the declared method you're going to use to do multiple class inheritance here under the hood to make sure that the prototype chains are all valid and we're bringing in the right constructors and we're mixing in all the properties correctly. And so we have scene layer that's going to extend the return value of this declared method, and using this constructor here as well as the scene service. And when you do that, your scene layer is going to be properly typed. You have all the interface extensions in there with all the property properties that it should have, as well as all the functions that it should have. This is, like I said, this is one way to do it. This sample here is a bit dated now. I talked to someone this week, one of our guys, he was saying that we changed it to just use the, if you create an interface, call it scene layer, the same name as the class, and give it the extensions of the layers. So if I, instead of calling this base here, if I would just call it this scene layer, then apparently this all should have worked. I haven't done it though, so I didn't want to just jump right into it, and I wasn't sure if I understood him correctly when we were talking to it. It was a late night, but that's the way it's supposed to work. So I will get new samples up, and we'll update our TypeScript helper stuff documentation to with those new ways as well. So let's see here. Do I want to come to the sample widget just yet? So how many people in here saw the custom widget development course by Franco and Matt? All right, awesome. So you guys saw plenty of TypeScript in that one, I'm sure. I didn't get a chance to see it. But if you're doing custom widget development with the JavaScript API, you're going to want to use TypeScript. Actually, you kind of have to use TypeScript right now. So let's get into the demos, and I'll cover some stuff. So first thing I want to cover, if you want to learn more TypeScript, I mean, really this SitePen's definitive TypeScript guide is probably one of the best resources for it. They've updated it just this week for the TypeScript 2.2 stuff. The TypeScript wiki is also very good. Not necessarily the handbook. The handbook's okay. The handbook's kind of a guide for TypeScript, but the TypeScript wiki has a lot of stuff in there. I mean, it's got stuff about what's coming in future versions of TypeScript, what's the road ahead, what have we done, some really great examples. It's a great guide to get through some stuff. So I just want to show our documentation page, but this, you can go here and it'll just take you to the TypeScript page that we have for learning about TypeScript with the JavaScript API. So what happened was is that we started documenting how to do custom widget development. We used TypeScript for everything. And then we had a couple of people working with that widget development guide in-house that were like, it's very thorough, but I had trouble getting, I didn't know where to start. I didn't know how to get a TypeScript environment set up or what to do. So we stepped back and we said, okay, well, let's put a guide together on getting you set up to build TypeScript applications. So we have a complete guide in here on setting up your development environment. It's got instructions on how to install the typings, how to set up your configuration, what is a tsconfig file, which I'll go over in a moment, how to compile your code from TypeScript to JavaScript, and everything else. We got folder structure stuff in here, which isn't a hard rule, but it's a recommended thing. And basically, actually, before I get to that, the guide that we provide to you is on GitHub in this JS API resources repo. It's the same folder that we provide the typings. You wouldn't necessarily download the typings directly from here, but the way you install them is with npm and use the @types namespace from npm, and we have the ArcGIS JS API on there. Now, by default, if you just do it this way, it's going to install it with the version 3 typings, I believe. I would have to double check. But you can, I'll show you how you get the version 4 typings by installing it like this. So I also wanted to show that we have a lot of samples in the Bower repo. So if you go to GitHub, the ArcGIS JS API repo, this is where we have the Bower release. We provide the source code unminified for the widgets in the JavaScript API. So this is the navigation toggle, for example. Notice the .tsx extension, meaning that there is JSX inside of this code. What's kind of neat, and I keep pointing out to people, is that if you're into documentation for whatever reason, if you're big on writing like your JS doc and stuff, you can see how we do it. I don't know how useful it really is, but this is really I copy this file directly from our internal Git repo, enterprise stuff into GitHub. So this is what we do. There was even at one point someone had a comment here, something like need to return, this is bad or something like that. It was a funny comment they left. And I told the guys, like, you guys know I publish this stuff on GitHub, right? And they're like, oh, crap, I forgot. So here we see an example of using like type in here. So we have a layout mode, vertical or horizontal. So types are really great for simple things like this. This is almost like an enum, right, inside of your TypeScript code. So it's a great way to kind of create these nice typings like that. And if you come down here, let's actually get some code here. Here we go. There we go. Navigation toggle extends declared widgets, so we have that widget in there. So we got a nice class, and things are broken down pretty nicely in here. We've got our constructor with optional arguments. And you can start looking through the code on the actual widgets to see how we're building them ourselves. Our driving force for doing this was so that you can see how we use the view models in the widgets to help you write your own widgets or write your own custom views. That was where that came from. All right, so let's get to some, let's see here. So these are my samples. All right, let's get some code. And I just need to find out where this demo is at so I can show you. So samples for Dev Summit 2017. Okay. Let's come here. So I've got this little application here. This application is actually available on GitHub, and I'll show you this repo later on. But all this application does is I'm pulling in a feature service, and I wanted to create a custom chart over here. And what I want this custom chart to do is change dynamically based on the data that's within my view. So right now in my view, there are 53 of these toxic release facilities. And I have a little chart here telling me the number of carcinogen versus this PBT, non-PBT, and metal. I didn't put numbers here. I could have put numbers in here, but I didn't. I just wanted to kind of show a chart. If this is like a demo purposes, but you can get pretty fancy with it. And when I zoom out, it's going to update the chart. So I've got new numbers here. I got 117 now. And we can just see as a comparison, we've got an awful lot more non-PBT facilities than we do some of the other ones. We still have a lot of carcinogen. I'm guessing PBT and metal are bad. I think all these are bad. They're toxic release facilities. This was part of something I did in school anyway. They're all bad when you see this output, but I mean, it's probably not as bad as it looks. And again, it just keeps changing every time my view changes or I pan the map around, it's going to update. All right, so I wanted to do this as a nice simple sample inside of TypeScript. So the way we can do that is I need to get a TypeScript project going. So the first thing I want to show you is for every TypeScript project that you write, you're going to want to have a tsconfig file. Now, the tsconfig has these compiler options. I'm not going to get into all of them. You don't need to get into all of them. You don't even need to know all of them really are. We have some in our sample that we provide via our GitHub sample that have a lot of these filled out. You could get into what a lot of these are when you start doing more development. Someone making fun of me walking by. the important part is the module part. So you have some options when you compile your TypeScript. You can do it as CommonJS, you can do it as system, meaning that you're going to be using SystemJS. That's what you would do if you're going to be doing Angular 2 stuff. You want to compile down to AMD because we do use AMD under the hood. No implicit any, meaning that this is a nice one. Do this because if you say no implicit any, that means that you have to type your stuff. You can't just let the compiler see that you have something typed at what may be an any property. No, don't get away with that. You gotta make it no implicit any equal to true. That way you can't get away with being really lax on your typings. You can remove comments. I'm not removing comments in this case. I have source maps. This one here, JSX. Okay, so this looks a little tricky. JSX, it has to just be React because JSX in TypeScript, the reason they had the TSX is because of React, but not everyone using JSX is using React. The key word is still React, though, in the compiler. So the JSX style is React, and unless someone changes JSX slightly for their purposes of development, there may be another naming convention down the road. I just leave it as React. They do have the React Native, which is the only one you use. So React like owns JSX at this point. I mean, they don't really own it, but it's like, you think React, you think JSX. And of course, React namespace, we're not using React for our JSX development, we're not using React for our widgets, so we have this custom method called JSX factory, which is gonna do the little method name, and I'm not gonna get into the hyperscript bit of this, how that gets compiled down, but you wanna target ES5 as your target, and this is where you can change things to be ES6, ES3 even, don't do ES3, do ES5. That way, everything will work in the browsers, and you'll be good and happy to go. You can attempt to go to ES 2016 if you wanted to, but I doubt that the browsers are gonna work with all of that good stuff. So with the other ones that are important here, I don't think there's anything else too important. Emit decorator data and experimental decorators. You want those to be true because we use decorators in the API. This types one here, one of the guys on our on the GeoDev team had me add this to our samples because apparently, and I heard about this before, but apparently Atom, the Atom decorator, or I'm sorry, Atom editor, it's early, needs this in the tsconfig.json so that it knows how to pull the at types typings, and I'll explain the at types stuff in a second here. But so you need to add this to Atom so that the Atom editor will work if you're doing JavaScript TypeScript development there. And just tell it what to include. I'm gonna include everything in my app folder. And these, finally, this was a big thing in tsconfig for a while too, is it didn't support file globs, and now it does, so you can just write this instead of having to write a path to every single file, where everybody wrote scripts to add these files dynamically during development. And I just wanna show you the package.json too, because in the package.json I have a couple of scripts. I have dev and tscw, which I'm actually running right now, so if I stop it, and I just run npm dev, all that's gonna do, it's gonna run the TypeScript compiler in watch mode, meaning that it's just gonna watch for my changes, and then recompile on the fly. Not a big deal. I'm not using grunt or gulp for this. The sample is not that complicated to have to do that, so I didn't wanna bother with it. Okay, so let's talk about the typings here. So you can see here, I've got a dependency on the JavaScript API typings version 4.2. Actually, I could update to 4.3, but I won't do it right now because I don't want to run an NPM install or anything. Network traffic kill you. So that's how you do. I haven't been able to figure out how to write a single line tslint command to lint all of my files, only one file at a time so far, but I'm working on it. But you could write a lint command for tslint. So if you use jshint or eslint, there is tslint. So you can have all these kind of different rules and how your TypeScript code should be written. I think some of mine are a little outdated at this point, but that's fine. I think this is a Visual Studio code problem. But anyway, this is rules you can put in place for people to write your TypeScript code. So, okay. It's a lot of cruft to get set for TypeScript. But once you got all that, you got your types installed, then you can start writing your TypeScript in here. So I have a main TS file here, and that's where I'm gonna get things started. One thing you'll notice that's a little different when you're working with the JavaScript API is that we have to do this import module name equals require and then the path to the modules. So we get asked a lot, why do I still have to do this in my TypeScript code? And the reason is that we still have to support JavaScript developers. We can't just drop everything and say that everyone has to work in ES6 land or in TypeScript. We're not gonna do that. We're still gonna support people that wanna write regular JavaScript without any of this extra stuff. And you have to do it this way because if we wrote the TypeScript in such a way that you can just do import Esri map from the Esri map module, you would have to, as a JavaScript developer, you would get the map object, but that wouldn't be your map. There'd be a default property on there, and that would be the constructor for the map. So you would have to say new map.default. We don't want to do that. I don't think our users want us to do that. There may come a time down the road when everybody's using ES6 across the board, and there's no need for us to worry about ES5 support anymore. When that day comes, then we'll do that. But as long as we have users that are just using regular JavaScript, we're not gonna do that. So unfortunately, this is how you have to bring in the code right now. Odd thing though, if you are doing, say, Angular 2 development, writing your TypeScript, you're not outputting to AMD at that point. You're gonna output to system modules, and when you output to system modules, the import from module name works. So it's only when you're outputting to AMD that you have to do it that way. I'm pulling in a couple modules here, the store and this widget init, which I'll show you in a second. And I have a configuration. This configuration is just a small file I have to give me information about what my layer URL, my map view options, and options for my map, like, you know, the base map and stuff. It's not huge, I won't even show it. I initialize this widget init, which I'll show in a moment. Then all I'm doing here is, and you notice I'm not even typing anything yet. I haven't written any types because the TypeScript compiler is going to know. So if I hover over this feature infos knows that it's going to have an ID, title, layer type, pop-up template, outfields, and URL. How does it know that? That's because the information that I'm giving it back from this filter is giving it back that information. I'm filtering out information from this parameter that I gave it. The parameter is inspected. TypeScript compiler knows what the type of that parameter or what the shape of the parameter is, and it's going to go ahead and infer that every time I do something. So that's why it knows that this feature info should look like that. All right, so that's pretty cool. The same for the map options. So the map options is going to go from the feature infos. I'm just going to get the layers out of there. And right now the layers is any. It shouldn't be, but it's any. And if we go over feature layer, it's going to tell you what the feature layer properties are. Although I can get around this by telling it that it's going to be, let's see, how do I do this here? I believe it's like this. Feature layer. Layers. It doesn't like that. All right. I won't bother doing that. That's what I get for trying to live code in a demo. Should have fixed that earlier. Okay, then I just create my web map, pass in my map options. One thing I like to do when I write my TypeScript and even ES6 code is instead of calling the Esri map module, instead of calling it map, I call it Esri map because there is a map, global map method inside of ES6 and TypeScript that is used for other purposes. It has nothing to do with spatial or geo. It's part of the spec, so that's why I call things Esri map, just so in my head I remember what I'm doing. So now I got my web map, I'm setting it to my map options, and I'm gonna pass that to my map view. So it's gonna create my view, and then I'm gonna set the view on my store, and I'll show the store in a moment, because I think the store is kinda cool. So I wanna show you this widgets one real quick, the core widgets I was talking about. So basically all I'm doing here is I'm bringing in all the different widgets I want to show in my application. I'm bringing in the watch utils library, which I suggest if you're going to be doing development and you want to watch for properties, use watch utils. It just it works a lot nicer than doing just like view.watch, which works, but I kind of like doing watch utils, watch, view, and then the properties, and I'll show that right now. This is my widgets here, the summary and the summary view model are my chart widgets. I'm pulling out the when once method from the watch utils. This is a nice little syntax you can do here. And then I'm just gonna do that watch for when the view changes on my store once. I only care about when it happens one time. If I do it again, I don't care. When it happened once, I'm gonna create this array of objects that are gonna be made up of my different widgets. And I actually requested our guy that does our widgets if he can add the functionality to the add method of our UI to support taking this objects here, and he added it for me because he thought it was a pretty good idea. So I can make my requests and people do things. It's nice. So I have an element position in here, and once I got all my widgets in here, I'm just going to go and pass them into I have a store method called add to UI. Notice I'm not working directly with the view here. I'm going to a different method that I've wrapped around my view to add to the UI here. So notice for me, I'm watching for when the view is changed on the store once, and where did I do that? I did that in my main.ts over here when I did store.set for web map and view. This is just the accessor stuff here, so if anyone saw our accessor demo theater, or if you've watched any of the like widget development or some of the other stuff, API fundamentals that we've done this week, we've talked about accessor and all of those. You can set multiple properties using the set method to set multiple properties on accessor. It works out pretty nicely. So this is saying I set the web map and web view view property. All right, so before I look at the widgets, let's look at the actual store itself, because I think the store is kind of cool. So I got this store in here. Again, since I'm going to be extending a class, I'm bringing in these decorator helpers and the extends helper. I'm watching my time. I think I'm okay. Okay, so again, I'm bringing in my map, bringing in the map view, and I'm bringing in accessor, because I'm going to extend the accessor in this case. Now I bring in subclass, declared and property for my decorator's helpers. Those are some decorators I'm going to use. I create a type UI params. I think I showed this in the slides earlier. So I have an optional position that I'm going to be passing in, along with an element of any, and I really shouldn't have made this an element of like a widget would have brought it in, but I'll leave it as any for now. Don't tell anybody I did that. So I have an interface for my store that I want. So my store, I want to have a web map, I want to have a view, and I want to have a method called addToUI that's going to take these parameters, and then it's up to me to decide what to do with that in my class. Now I'm in a subclass here, and you don't have to pass a string. It's just kind of, we do it in the API because it does some other stuff under the hood for us to find classes. But I'm going to subclass this decorator here, and I have a class called AppStore. It extends the declared method. I'm only going to be extending accessor, but we talked about declared earlier, and we use that to do multiple class inheritance. And I'm going to implement my store interface. So just by adding the little property decorator onto these, the web map and the view property, automatically I know that when I can watch for property changes, watch for those properties to change. That's very easy to do using the accessor. It's part of the reasons that we love it so much. Then I got this add to UI method here, and then for the add to UI, I'm just going to go to the view that I have in my property here, go to the UI, go to add, and add the element and add position in here. And actually, I don't even need to do this anymore. I think I just add the whole thing now. That's the support you added for me, but this sample's still in 4.2, and I didn't want to do the 4.3 stuff just yet because I have to download the new typings, and then it takes too long. Well, it may take too long. I don't know on this network. So that's it. That's how you use a store. And this is essentially this is how you write a view model as well. It's pretty much the same concept. You extend accessor, use these decorators that we have inside of the TypeScript helpers and stuff, and you just set things to be able to watch for properties. It's a very simple pattern that you can use inside your own application. It just so happens that in this case, instead of a view model, I'm using it as a store or data store from application, but it's really just like a view model for the whole application, not just a widget. All right, so let's look at the actual summary widget that I have in here. So this is now where I got my TSX file, and I'll show that JSX stuff in a moment. But again, I'm doing the same thing. I'm going to extend the widget class. It's instead of the accessor, but it's all the same concept. I'm bringing in some extra decorators in here. I'm bringing in this alias of, which I'll show in a moment. I'm bringing in renderable join, which is kind of cool. And I had to ask how to do certain things. They told me, oh, use the join decorator. I was like, oh, that's awesome. It's not a decorator. It's a helper method, really. And then the JSX factory, which doesn't get used, but it will get used during the compilation time. But you won't use it yourself manually. I have this little constant for all my CSS stuff in here. And this is where the join comes in pretty handy, because I'm changing CSS color and sizing in my chart widget, and I need to join different classes to do different things, and we'll see why in a moment. So I create a type called style, and that style is going to have a target. That target is going to have the stats in here, and I thought I had stats somewhere. Where's my stats? Import stats. I forget where that stats type is at. And then I have a multi number, and I forget why I called it multi. That's a horrible name. I never should have done that, because now you already forgot what it's supposed to mean. You'll see what it means when I get to it. So then I have a nice little function here that extracts all the values from an object. So I have a value. These are the numbers that are for these toxic release facilities in my feature layer that have these like different the PBT maybe 100, non-PBT is 20, and so on. I need to get those numbers out somehow. And what I want to do is I don't want, when I size my chart, I don't want it to go to, like, I don't want to go say that it's 100. If it changes to 200, double the size, like, you know, to the top of my page. I want to keep these other values within the same height, right? Like, I don't want some random numbers showing up in my height. So I want to keep a maximum value. So what I do is find the maximum value that is in that set of data. This code here, I wrote it because it looks really cool, right? I'm using the REST operator and stuff like that. This is probably a very, very bad way to write your code, because if I gave this to another developer, he's going to get mad at me and go, what does that even mean? It It looks horrible. I think it looks cool, but it's not very expressive. It doesn't really tell you what's happening. So I would probably change this if I were putting this out into production, but it made me feel nice. I have this rounding function here that I'm gonna use as well. I'm basically just rounding the numbers. It's a function to help me round out numbers that are in somewhere. And then what you wanna do is you need to, you want inline styles, right? So I'm gonna have inline styles inside of my my DOM, right? I need to have those styles in there. So I'm gonna turn the values that are in the values that are in the data for these toxic release facilities into heights that I'm adjusting in my chart. It's very simple. I'm just kind of turning value to height. That's all I'm going to do. So I'm going to go over I'm going to use object.keys in here and go over that particular feature and, you know, turn the height into the values there. And I've already kind of normalized them. I will be normalizing them at the data coming in using the rounding and getting the maximum value and stuff. So I'm just going to extend my widget and have a couple aliases in here. I have a view model I wrote for the widget, and I'm just going to say that the view model has a count property, but I want that count property on my widget, so I have an alias of to do this for me. It takes care of that. So as the view model property changes, the property on the widget is going to change. And this is more widget specific stuff, I know, but this is all the heavy TypeScript stuff that we do in the API. And then we have this renderable, meaning that when the property changes on the widget for this renderable, then you need to run the render function again, or get took into the render lifecycle to see if anything changed and then rerun itself. And the VDOM stuff that we use under the hood will figure out if the properties really did change or if I just set them to something equal again. It will figure all that nice stuff out for you. So I have a view model in here. The view model is a type of the view model. I'm just going to initialize it right there in my property. I'm going to say that view model is equal to a new view model. That's all I got to do. So here's our render function. So here's where I get my maximum values. And I'm rounding out my maximum values using the functions I showed you earlier. Oh, multiplier. Multi meant multiplier for the, that I want to change the height. So if I think the chart's too small, I can change the multi real quickly to like 3 or 4, and it'll go ahead and multiply my chart heights by that value. I knew I'd figure it out. So I'm getting my chart height in here. So my chart height is going to be equal to the maximum value. So none of these values can ever go past the maximum height of my chart, which is kind of nice. And then I'm getting my styles using my inline style. And we'll see how the styles work in a moment. So I like the idea, and the widget guys do this because it's very cool, is using a constant for our CSS and the widgets. And then we can just refer to those properties in the constants when we're using the classes. So I have like a base class, I have a container class. I can just go ahead and put the count for the facilities number. We saw that count value when I did the widget. The cool thing here is that if I want to join multiple classes together, so like I have a class defining what a column is, but then I also have a class defining what the color of the column should be, and I need to join those two classes together. This is how you would do it in the widget development. And I don't know if they showed this in the custom widget development. I'm assuming they did because it's kind of a cool feature that we have in the API. Then I have a very poor way of grabbing my styles out for the style for each of these columns. I was trying to figure out a better way to show this for the demo, but I was like, this works. I'm not trying to get fancy about it. I'm just pulling out the array at the correct index for that particular column. I'm doing more joining in here of the, this is for the little kind of legend looking thing at the bottom of the chart. And that's essentially it. At that point, I can go ahead and I can export this widget. And if we look at the view model for it, which I'll show as well, the view model, again, I'm extending accessor. I'm using watch utils internally in the view model. I'm going to do some stuff at the feature layer view, which is kind of cool. And I'm working with graphics and queries in here. So I get my little decorator helpers, doing all kinds of cool stuff. Here's that type stats, which I was looking for in here. It's basically saying that I have these different fields, and they're going to have number types. And I have another type stats, or the constant stats, that matches my type to give my default values, which are going to be 0 when I start off, right? So that means I have a flat chart, nothing happening, and I'm just going to populate that, and the data will change. I got my little error handler, same stuff we've seen before. But what I'm doing here in my constructor is I'm gonna, again, watch for once when the view changes, and when the view changes, I'm gonna find the layer that I wanna work with. When I find that layer I wanna work with, it's going to become part of my promise chain because I'm returning it. And when I get that layer, I'm gonna wait, I wanna do the, get the layer view for that particular layer. Because I'm concerned for my chart purposes of the data in my view. I don't care about all the data on the server. I'm concerned about what I'm looking at. So I want the layer view information. So I'm gonna get the layer view by passing this function when layer view my layer. When that comes back, I have another method here called watch layer view, which I'll show you, that I'm just binding this property to. I probably should have found a better way to do this method in here, but this works. And if you don't know bind, it's just how you pass context to functions. So then here's my watch layer view, and notice I got private method in here. So if you use C#, you probably just got really happy. You can use private and protected methods. So I got my watch layer view method in here, get my layer view back, and I'm gonna query the layer view. And then I have this init value, meaning I'm gonna initialize when I do my watch, the view.stationary. This is one of the things you gotta do when you're working with the layer view bits, or I wanna make sure that things aren't, I don't wanna do any of my querying really until I'm done moving the map, until I get finalized, because if I didn't, I would be querying the map as I'm panning, so I wanna wait till it stops, wait till it's done updating, then I can query the map. So I watch for this layer view updating to be false. When that's false, then I can do my query. If it's, if the layer view is updating. If the layer view is not updating, then I'll just do my query directly. Again, this might be able to be written a little more, probably could be done a little better, but it works for now. I could probably update this at some point down the line. And the query of my layer view is just basic. I'm gonna query the layer view. I don't think I need to, for 4.3, I don't need to do new query anymore. I can just pass this object in, but I think at one point I had to do new query. And I give it the geometry, which is gonna be the view of my, or the extent of my view, but I'm gonna get that view from the store. So I'm taking the extent of the view, doing a query on the layer view, and getting that data back. The reason we do this is that I didn't understand this until like a couple releases ago. I was under the impression that the layer view always had the features that were only drawn on the map, and that's not the case. It has all the features available to draw on the map. So there could be features in the layer view which are not currently visible on the map just because we haven't drawn them. So if you want to get layers that are only visible, pass a query using the view extent and it'll get them out. But it'll pull it locally. It's not gonna go back to the service to try and get the data when you do the layer view. It's only gonna work with the data that's currently available in the view. And I just have this method here for parsing my results. I won't go into detail on this one here because it's basically just taking my feature layer data that I got back and or the features that I get back and converting them to this little stats object I have to update the numbers that are in there. So I started with 0 and I'm gonna go up to like 50 or 20, whatever, per that request. And those change. And when those change, I'm gonna update the stats and I'm gonna update the count, which I'm covering up. I'll update the count, it's just gonna be the length of the results I got back. Because that makes it very easy for me to do in my view that we saw here to just put my count in here in my little title. And that is how, if I'm wrong direction, this particular works. We see the count changing there. We see the chart sizes are gonna change as needed. And we get nice little chart capabilities in there. Okay, so that was that. Now, if you wanted to do something like use the dojo typing, so let's say you wanna do dojo on, I got like 1 minute, I can show this, I think. What you can do, because we don't really, I think we might show this in the docs a little bit, but if you want to do it, you're gonna do npm I, or npm install, not npm watch, dojo typings, right? I'm gonna save that. So it's gonna install my typings for me, hopefully pretty quickly. Yeah, that was pretty quick. So now what you need to do is you can do one of two things. And I'm actually gonna go back to the repo because I at one point had fixed this. So let's go over here. And I'll just show this in my actual repo because this sample is on GitHub. So it's right here. And I'm gonna go to look at the history. Actually, no, let's go to, am I gonna have it? commits. Come on. Ah, took it out. But you're basically, what you're gonna do is, there are, and the only reason I'm not showing them all, because there's like five modules or four from the Dojo typings you'd want. You'd want the Dojo X, Dojo, Digit and stuff. And you would actually create a new file, or I would recommend create a new file called typings.d.ts. Add those typings in here, and then all you have to do at that point is go to your TS config and add them in here. And you'll just say typings, oops, not dot typings, typings.d.ts. So these are typings specific for application. The only reason you have to do this at the moment is the fact that the official Dojo typings are not published into NPM as part of the @types namespace. And TypeScript 2 uses the @types namespace. It used to be, before that was available, you would use tools like, there was a tool called typings. There was one called, oh, I can't remember the name anymore, TSD, I believe it was, that you would use to install these typings. It would manage these declaration files and stuff for you. You normally don't need to do that anymore, except in the case you want to use Dojo. And then what you're doing here is you do the point to where it's going to be at, like the node modules folder and stuff, and there's some syntax there, and you're going to be nice and happy. And I forget what it even looks like at this point. But if you come into the node modules and we look at the @types one here, actually Dojo typings, my bad. Look at Dojo typings here and look at their index.ts. You can see these references, how they look in here. So I take those and copy them in here. Now I'm gonna add node modules to the path name. And I think I have to have Dojo typings, like so. And you can just add that like that. So now you have the Dojo typings available to you. If you wanted to work with the Dojo stuff inside of your application, you would do this probably if you're doing 3x and you wanted to do TypeScript. This is a case where you would do something like this. Like I said, we can publish ours typings to the @types namespace, but Dojo hasn't published the Dojo 1 typings up there yet. It's just npm install to get these Dojo typings. And I have an extra thing there. And with that, I'm lost. There we go. This is just a link to the guide that we have on the JavaScript documentation for getting your TypeScript development environment set up. And then at this point, I think I got time for questions if you guys want. So, any questions at the moment? No? That was a camera that went up. Everyone gonna go back now and start using TypeScript for all of their development? Yeah? Excitement, I see. It's still a little early, I know. Sorry. All right, well, thank you very much. I appreciate it.